Good morning. I am truly honored to be with you this morning as we celebrate and commemorate the life and legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I want you to know that my comments, all of my remarks, are my own and should in no way be interpreted as me speaking for the university or any member of our institution. I have entitled my remarks, Witness to History, a brief chronology of Martin Luther King Jr., the Orwellian state, and the quest for freedom. So what does the life and legacy of Dr. King have to do with George Orwell's work, 1984? That link may be a little challenging, but bear with me through the next few minutes. I can tell you now that it encompasses the enduring ideas of faith and courage. This presentation will note the significance of Orwell's work, 1984, and then briefly examine Dr. King's life as a witness to history, an attempt to connect his life and legacy to our current human quest for freedom, which includes equality, justice, and peace. Briefly, you will recall that the science fiction novel 1984 was written by English author George Orwell, and this book was published in 1949. The prophetic novel tells of a dystopic, upside-down world that is marked by never-ending war, which, of course, we now call perpetual war. It is marked by government surveillance of the entire population, and we now refer to this as mass surveillance. And the book also talks about the manipulation of language and history, the censorship of the press and possessions, and the drive to eliminate the individual as a unique person, including making what you think an actual crime. The very idea of human freedom, the mere quest for freedom, is criminalized. The influential book gives us terms and concepts we continue to cite today. Big Brother, Doublethink, Newspeak, etc. In addition to Big Brother, the foreboding face of the watchful government, we have the little everyman Winston Smith against the powerful status quo. In the novel, Smith's job is to rewrite history so that it agreed with the propaganda of the prevailing political atmosphere. The novel gives us a glimpse of the ultimate totalitarian state, ruled by the 1-2%, with the masses ground down into a dark oblivion. They have poor access to food, water, shelter, and clean air. In this novel, Orwell was satirically criticizing World War II, Stalin's Soviet Union, and Nazi Germany. However, Orwell was not the first writer to speculate post-war about the advent of the totalitarian state. Russian novelist Yevgeny or Eugene Zamyatin published his work We in 1921, which was translated for the English market in 1924. Today, however, when we want to talk about the coming of fascism and authoritarian government, we more often than not refer to it as Orwellian. Now let us turn to a brief chronology of Dr. King's life. A personal timeline of his life is important because so often when we speak of King, we don't necessarily investigate or interrogate his life. To be sure, King, like the African-American population at the time, from the 1920s through the 1960s, was born into a world that was no less Orwellian for blacks because it was covered in the vulgar patina of racism and white supremacy. This work was embedded with Jim Crow racial segregation laws and social practices, lynching murders, police brutality, a dystopic world where blacks were historically relegated to a second-class citizenship. So let us look briefly at Dr. King's life. As you know, King was born on January 15, 1929, in Atlanta, Georgia. He was a man who came from a long line of distinguished ministers, and he and his father, Daddy King, purportedly both named Michael, took on the name Martin Luther. And if I may take a moment here to comment on the significance of the man behind the name Martin Luther. Martin Luther was the German monk and scholar who ushered in the Protestant Reformation in the European 1500s. Martin Luther condemned several doctrines of the Roman Catholic Church, and in his 95 Theses, he denounced abuses within the church's practice of buying one's sins, known as indulgences, and he was ultimately excommunicated. His conception of the Bible and Christ and his translation of the Bible in an effort to make it more accessible to the masses challenged the papal authority. So we have Daddy King referring to himself as Martin Luther, a man born more than four centuries prior, a man of another race, time, and place, and then calling his son Michael by that name, the name of a holy man who bravely challenged the prevailing state authority and was persecuted for it. Our Martin Luther King Jr. attended Morehouse College in Atlanta in 1944. Early in his pre-ministerial career, King demonstrated that he would be a great leader of the people, one who would fight for the rights of African Americans, just like his father and his grandfather. In 1946, he published a letter to the editor of the Atlanta Constitution, reminding the community that blacks were citizens of the United States and fully entitled to the rights of citizenship. 2 years later, in 1948, he became an ordained minister and assistant pastor at the Ebenezer Baptist Church. Also in 1948, King graduated with a BA in sociology from Morehouse, and then he began the ministerial program at Crozer Theological Seminary. And note, the next year is when Orwell's novel 1984 was published. King, at Crozer, received another BA in Divinity and was the commencement speaker. He moved on to graduate studies in the early 1950s at Boston University. And it was also during the 1950s that he met and married Coretta Scott. He began his family and a pastorship at the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church in Montgomery, Alabama. He received a doctorate from Boston University in systematic theology. By now, King had distinguished himself as a prominent Christian minister, an erudite theologian, and a serious scholar. In the mid-1950s, Dr. King's life truly starts to change. It was the time where he was thrust into history. The Montgomery Improvement Association was formed to address the arrest of Rosa Parks, a black woman who refused to give up her seat to a white bus passenger in the archaic Jim Crow ritual practice based solely on racial discrimination and white supremacy. There would be a boycott, and King was elected president of the Montgomery Improvement Association. To be sure, these were turbulent times. Even some upwardly mobile blacks had accepted the status quo, wrought from generations of racial subjugation. The idea that they would be allowed to live and perhaps even prosper a little in small spaces, as long as they didn't draw attention to themselves or attempt to rock the racial boat. If there was ever a time for such a person to quit, stop, bow out, or conform, that was it. But King was made of other stuff, stronger stuff. He was recognized as a leader, and he began almost immediately receiving threats of all kinds. Some of these threats became real when his home and offices were bombed. Yet according to King, he had a spiritual awakening that told him to continue the course. And by the late 1950s, the Montgomery bus lines were desegregated. During this time, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference was convened, and King was appointed its chair. He was known as a key voice among courageous black leaders, especially ministers, who were determined to fight racial discrimination in the U.S. In fact, he was featured on the cover of Time magazine, and his reach was widespread. He met with statesmen abroad, and then the then current president of the United States, Eisenhower. And he published his first book, Stride Toward Freedom, The Montgomery Story, in 1958. Also, King was publicly attacked when a mentally disturbed black woman, during a book signing for Stride Toward Freedom, stabbed him with a letter opener. His life was miraculously spared, and King, the man he was, acknowledged her mental illness with compassion and forgave the woman. By the 1960s, Dr. King had left Montgomery, Alabama, and returned to Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta. He participated in protests and sit-ins, and he was arrested with countless activists. But King did so while facing every obstacle the local, state, and federal government placed before him. As the turbulent decade of the 1960s got underway, King met with President Kennedy and pressured him to issue an Emancipation Proclamation towards ending racial segregation in the United States. But the verbal and physical attacks did not subside. King was also attacked by the American Nazi Party. However, this did not stop him. He continued the protests and went on to write his letter from a Birmingham jail in 1963, telling African American and Jewish clergymen that blacks could not wait for justice. Accepting an even larger public platform, on August 28, 1963, King delivered the keynote address at Bayard Rustin and A. Philip Randolph's March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. Over 200,000 people converged on the Lincoln Memorial, and they heard King's message of racial justice and unity in his I Have a Dream speech, where he talked about the equality of mankind. Not long after this seminal event, King delivered the eulogy for three